Welcome to Relaxing Watercolor. Today I'll be doing a sunset landscape, and you're welcome to join me if you like. I'm inspired by this stock photo. That and all the tools that I'm using are listed in the description below. I'm starting out with a wet and wet wash technique, and dropping in some lemon yellow to start with. But let's add some rose madder to that mix and make an orange. I'm using a number 12 round synthetic squirrel brush, but you can use any brush that you like. Now I'm going to grab some cerulean blue and just drop in the color. I'm inspired by, but not bound to, the stock photo. So just take your time and have some fun and place the color where it wants to go. Watch it kind of do its thing. It's kind of amazing. Now I'm managing the water here. There's a little too much. So let's work on the water in the painting. And for this, I'm using horizontal strokes. To mirror the color, I'm using the same mixtures as the sky. As the paper dries, the mixture will be darker, and that's because there's less water, so it's less diluted. Now, to mirror the sky, I'm also using the same amount in the water below. In the stock photo, I notice there's a beautiful reddish-orange mixture in the water, but it's very soft, so I want to add it now. This will dry slightly lighter. I think it'll be just right, but we'll find out. And now let's work again on the water using horizontal strokes. You don't have to be perfect. It's all about just enjoying the flow. So when I'm doing water, mostly I just kind of let the brush dance across the paper. And that allows some kind of wiggly, wavy, horizontal lines. Alright, let's manage this water, and I think that will actually be the focus of today's video. Let's try a thirsty brush lift technique. What that is basically the brush is dry when you're touching it to the paper. Or at least mostly dry. Alright, let me show you how it's done. See how it's sucking up this water here? So what you want to do is get it clean and then dry it off as much as possible. It'll leave room in the brush for more things to be picked up. Alright, let's get it all sucked up in there. So every time during this video that you see me wiping my brush on that towel over there, that's exactly what I'm getting ready to do, is to lift. Alright, let's let that dry and meet back here. Drying time will vary based on your environment. Let's dip into lemon yellow and rose madder. What I'm doing here is a wet on dry wash technique. And basically what that means is that the paper is dry first. And I do this because now I'll have greater control over the colors and where they're placed. And here what I'm doing is just creating more vibrancy and more brightness to that orangey yellow. In the stock photo, it's really bright and vibrant. And that's difficult sometimes in watercolors, so we'll see what I can do. white and just dropping in some orange. And now I'm going to grab some cerulean blue and neutral mix. For this here, I'll talk about that neutral mix in just a moment, but what's really key here is not to touch this blue to the orange right now. And the reason why is because the two are a little too wet, and when touched would really meld together and create a brownish gray. But we'll come back to it later and mush the two together. But for right now, we're going to keep them a little bit separate. They're just sort of talking to each other. They're not yet married. It's like a little romance in the clouds. All right, let's lift up some of these hard edges. And while I do that, you can kind of observe how I do it and sort of how I hold my brush. Pay attention to how patient I am with some of those edges. Take your time, there's no rush. We're not being timed. Oh, and that neutral mix, let's talk about that. So what you can use there's a lot of different options here. You can use a black, like ivory black, Morris black, that'll all work. You could also use Payne's gray, that's a beautiful gray. It's kind of on the cool side. But for me, I love to mix my neutrals. It tells me what my palette is actually doing when I mix my neutrals. I know the ratios, and it's really just great practice for playing with the color. Oh, so here I am lifting now. Finally, the paper is dry enough, it's still damp, but it's not puddly anymore. So now I'm just dabbing my thirsty brush over that area. And it'll be a lot softer. You see? Oh my. Alright. So yeah, so a neutral mix is pretty great. You can actually find my neutral mix at the end of this video. I actually recorded it separately and it's at the credits. So if you want to copy exactly how I created that neutral mix, you're welcome to. So you can pause here and then go check that out and then come back if you like. And I've left links in the description for those timestamps, so you'll be able to just jump around. Alright, so you see I've dropped in some orange while I was chit-chatting. And what we're doing here is now lifting that hard edge. And you can see really well with this orange exactly what I mean by a hard edge. Now some look distinctly cloud-like, and I kind of like them. So what's cool is you can kind of pick and choose where you soften. And over here on this side, I really want to create a little bit more drama. So what I'm going to do is just drop in some cerulean blue neutral mix and really punch up that contrast right there. I'll put a little on the other side too, just for some balance. So I like to kind of try to keep the edges loose. If you prefer to tape your piece off, that's also a very common practice. But I guess I'm a little rough around the edges. I'm just lifting and kind of taking that lifted paint and moving it around. All right, let's get that dry and start sucking up this hard waterline that's dry. So you can lift paint. Oh, I'm dropping in some color in the water really quick. We'll get back to that later. Okay, and adding some more rose matter. this is a really light, watery wash, and that lightens up the color and makes it paler. We're just going to add some extra oomph to the edges of these clouds. There we go. Not near the sun though. We want that to be bright. We can add a little to the water below as well. It's nice how watercolor is transparent, so we can layer this. Okay, so now I'm going to lift the edge where the sun would be and soften all around. All right. And now I'm just trying to clean up my mess a little. Oh my. Alright, so now let's do some dry brush technique along the water. That's when there's less water on the brush. Let's give some texture and strokes to that water and let this dry. Let it dry for about an hour, give or take, depending on your environment, the humidity, etc. Let's grab some Prussian blue and neutral mix and see what we're working with here. Maybe I'll add a little bit of rose madder and make just a slight warmer color. Yeah. Alright, I'm gonna grab some water and then I think this, what's on my brush, is ready. So I'm looking at the stock photo, but again, just really loosely basing my painting on it. And as the brush is starved of paint and slowly gets lighter and lighter, I'm just going to continue on and keep going, and I can drop more color in at the edge. But it works in our favor. Yeah, I'll drop some more right here. But it works in our favor for the sun area. You know, right in here, that's lighter in the middle, so that works really well for our purposes. So here I'm just using the same color and adding even more darkness and definition to these clouds on the edges. Alright, now I'm going to start lifting. What I want to do is just very gently get just the edge and soften it. You see how it just takes that hard edge off, that waterline? Makes it a little more fluffy cloud looking. Alright. So, this takes some time and patience. You don't have to do all of it, but I just love the very meditative and relaxing quality that lifting watercolor brings. Now we have a nice little cloud cutting right through the middle of our sky. There you go. Now, lifting pigments is not always easy, so let's take a moment to discuss lifting staining versus non-staining pigments. Over here in the corner of my book, I made kind of a mess with the rose madder. And this pigment, unfortunately, is not so forgiving. You can scrub, and you can see I'm doing maybe a little bit of damage to the paper and the brush with all of this manipulation of the paper, but you can see how lifting the Prussian blue and neutral mix is a lot easier then lifting that rose madder. Speaking of which, I'll add some more. So learning your pigments and knowing which ones are staining and non-staining is really helpful when you're doing this kind of work. I'm much more careful with that red than anything else. Speaking of that, let's jump on over to rose madder and cerulean blue. And I'm going to grab this really rich color and drop it in the water. And I'm just looking at the stock photo, and somewhere along here, let's say right here, we'll put this color at the bottom of the cloud. Make it really seem very sunsetty with this kind of muted purple. Kind of like a raspberry color, maybe? And I like that color so much, I'd like to drop it in some other places in the clouds and kind of tie it all together. And now, let's lift that hard edge right along there. Soften things up a little bit more. And clean up my mess again. I'm sorry, guys. And let's go to the cloud edges again. What's amazing about lifting is that it really allows you to erase any kind of thing you don't like with your piece. So don't be afraid to make mistakes. Nobody's perfect, right? Okay, so let's soften some of these lines in the water. Just by running a damp brush over it, that should smooth things over a little bit. And jump back over to lemon yellow and rose madder and kind of warm up the edges of that yellow puddle that I have in the middle of my water. Now I'm using lemon yellow, rose madder, and cerulean blue, but it's mostly rose madder. Let's soften that edge there just a little, scuff it up. Alright. And then drop some of that in there and kind of add a little something to our clouds up top. There we go, a little more softening of that waterline there. You don't have to get it all. And just smudging things. I'm leaving some of the little bumps here and there. This is all personal preference and style. You can lift or leave as much as you like. Alright, I think I'm just about finished fussing. Maybe a little more here and there, just for good measure. Okay, so I've done a little bit of damage here, so I'm going to repair it. There we go, there's a lifting of that bit there. And if you've made a mistake, just put a darker color over it. Boom. And this should fix what I've done. go. We'll see. Just put a little in the water like it's supposed to be there. Yeah, we're good. Let's just add some little final touches here in the water. Lift a little bit left of that cloud. Just a touch. And let's let that dry for about half an hour. But through the magic of editing, I'm gonna grab my ruler and a graphite pencil on this dry painting. Voila! Magic. And right here I'm just trying to figure out where the horizon line should go. Pick anywhere that makes sense for your particular piece. That looks sort of right to me. And this is just a guide. You don't have to color inside the lines. Alright, let's grab our cerulean blue. And we're going to start sort of finishing up the sky and the background so that we can really begin working on those trees that you see in the picture. And here I'm just making that blue a little more rich, softening water lines that I don't like. Filling in areas that are a little funky. Kind of evening out the border. Whatever feels right to you is right because it's your painting. Let's add a little neutral mix to that. But it's still mostly cerulean. And let's really fill our water with some vibrant blue. There we go. That's better. And it doesn't have to be straight. In fact, you can kind of wiggle your lines on purpose. As long as they're generally horizontal. Now, as I get closer to the horizon, I try to make them lighter and smaller. And just a lighter touch and let the paint kind of get starved. And then as I come down towards the foreground, well, right here I'm actually sort of blending and lifting. But you saw earlier how I used bigger, bolder strokes with darker color at the very bottom. So I'm softening up the edges. And now we're going to jump over. I still want to use the blue, but we're going to really mix this now with quite a bit of rose madder. So I'm going to put it over on the warm side of my palette because it's mostly rose. And maybe that's a little too much. There we go. This is like a reddish purple, but muted because I'm using cerulean and not a cool blue. Here we go. This purple is perfect for a sunset. Now I'm going to lift what I just put down. Since rose madder is staining, I'd like to try and get this right out the gate, if I can. That's better. And let's put in a hint of where the land would go. And you know, I'm just using that horizon line as a guide. But the land comes in and goes out and does all kinds of things. So you put it where it makes sense for you. And lightening it up now. And putting in some more land in the distance there. I'm looking at the stock photo, but as you can see, there's no actual purple in the trees. This is a bit of artistic license. Now you could use a different color, obviously, whatever you like. I just had a vibe for the purple today, so I thought it would work. We'll see. And now I'm just dropping in some darker purple and making trees. And this is really fun. It's a great way to create shadows when something is backlit. Is by first putting a lighter layer down and then dropping in darker color where the objects are. And I'm just sort of creating squiggles and dots and lines. It looks really complex, but really that's all I'm doing is just squiggles, dots, and lines. So there's a line, there's some dots and squiggles. I'm putting in the trunks first, just to get an idea of where they might live. And then going through and adding more detail. Dots are awesome for leaves, especially faraway leaves. Alright, so So that little landmass is done. I'll let that dry for about a half an hour. And magically, it's done. It's not quite dry. Actually, I got a little impatient. But I'm lifting the areas that are dry. You can see by the sheen on the paper. And now I'll use our dark purple mix that we created before. Since this isn't quite completely dry, I'm going to use that to our advantage and drop in some color where it's maybe a little lighter, where maybe the color settled away from it. Now I'm using smaller dots with just a delicate, patient hand. You can also use a smaller brush, but I wanted to design this particular video to be a single brush video. So you can see I'm just, luckily the point of this is still fairly good. I can go in with just the most delicate of hands and put in some small detail. Alright, after letting it dry for just a bit, I'm grabbing my smaller brush. I've caved. I was trying to make it a one brush video, however, I felt like I wasn't doing the piece justice. I can get a lot more detail, so I've switched to this very small detail brush, but I do this at the very end after all of the major elements are established. This means that I'm not going to have a lot of itty-bitty brush strokes over a large area. Now I'm mixing more of that beautiful cerulean and rose madder mixture, but I want to add a little more depth, so I'm adding Prussian blue to this mix. So this is an even deeper, darker violet. Knowing how rich it is, you really have to be judicious and choose exactly where the detail goes. I'm getting a sense for how much paint is on my brush and also how dark it is on a scrap. Now I'll be going along the waterline and establishing the mass, the base of this mass of land, and just adding some squiggles and wiggles. And since it's a smaller brush, we're going to have to palette a lot more. But I've added some water to increase the spreadability of the paint. It's a very rich color, so it does lighten up a little, but not too bad. Now I'm adding little tiny details near the waterline, and this is something that would be very, very difficult with that larger brush. And basically what I want to do here is just create some little shapes, almost indicating rocks or a shoreline. But it is so small, guys, so you don't have to fuss about too much detail. Now using horizontal strokes, adding some depth to that water, especially right around the shore. Alright, so now we are coming into the darkness of the forest, and I want to create more depth here. It's farther away from our light source, so I'm creating some darker land masses. It's in the shadowy side. And I'm also creating some shadows in the most detailed area of the piece, which is the trees and that shoreline there. Just playing around, creating some lines and squiggles. Now, you can go as far as you like to with the detail. You can add detail to the whole piece, or just a little bit of it, or none at all. Again, this is all your stylistic preference. So use my video as a guide if you'd like to try this yourself. But don't get fussed if they don't look exactly alike, because my hands are not the same as your hands. It's wonderful to have you painting with me. If you're here at this point, then I think that you've created something pretty amazing. So I'm going to teach you a trick, a secret. You can rotate your paper for easier reflections. So whatever's here, just carry it through as if you're drawing a straight line. But instead, on this side of the bank, your line is made up of little dashes. And this will help your eye see, but can be sometimes difficult when the paper is upright. I hope that you liked my little trick. If you did, give this video a thumbs up. I would really appreciate all of your support for my brand new channel. So you can see here I'm using a dry brush technique again. This is when all of the brush's water is gone. And I'm just smearing the dry paint all over, but it creates a really great watery effect. So there's another little tip for you. All right, but don't worry, I won't give away all of my secrets in this very one video. So don't forget to come back, subscribe, and check out my other ones in the future. I'm really excited about this channel, and I hope that you are too. Okay, so detailing can take quite a while, but I'm actually getting to be kind of happy. I think I'll just add some detail here and there. And then we'll skip on into the neutral mix video at the end of this video. So stick around during the credits. I'll show you exactly how I mixed my gray, which I used throughout this video. And if you like color mixing videos, please just let me know in the comments below. And let me know what colors you'd like me to make. And I can do my best to accommodate you. Okay, so to soften some of those lines, I'm just taking some plain water and just going over them. This kind of blurs things out a little, but it's still there. But while I'm using this wash, I'm going to just create some soft reflections by using my trick of just drawing the lines right across the river. So now here's another technique, which is really fun. You can kind of squiggle the lines by drawing through them after you've placed them. So there's a lot of ways to accomplish all sorts of different looks. There's no right or wrong way to do anything, so that's the beauty of art, is we can do what we like. hope that through the process of doing these videos on my channel, I improve in my own techniques and we can learn together. So here I decided that this here landmass looked a little too unfinished. And I wanted to add just a little bit more detail to the waterline to give it a feeling that it's not a cloud, but instead a piece of land. So I'm going to let that dry for about 15 minutes. And then through the magic of editing, I'm grabbing our cerulean blue rose matter and Prussian blue mix. And I'm just adding some little final touches. These are all just dots and squiggles. Nothing fancy. Little dots here and there to indicate more leaves. Just gives it a more finished look, a little more interest. Something to catch the eye when you arrive at this area. And over here, I'm not going to worry too much about that. In this spot where the light is catching right there in this little circle of detail. The sun is right there behind those clouds. So we want this area to really feel like it's catching all of our attention. And now the paintbrush hardly has any paint on it. And now I think I'm going to add some of the same color. Let me make sure I'm in camera. Let me just add the same color to some of the edges of the water that seem unfinished. And I like using the colors in the land, in the water as well. So I'm using a dry brush technique. Not dipping my brush in the water, but this means that I have to dip into the pigment quite often. So I apologize for the back and forth. It's like a tennis match over here now. But we're getting there. Alright, so here we have some blotchy areas. We can fix any blotchiness with just a darker color. The beauty of watercolor. And along this bright area that where the yellow is in the water, just wanted to create some more interest and contrast. But yeah, fixing mistakes is also a great use for this. And down here, where the land meets the water at the edge of the paper, this right here, it's a little too contrasty. That's not where I want my eye to go, so I'm gonna dull that down. And just tiny little brush strokes, just the lightest of touches on the paper. Okay. I think we're getting there. Oh my. So the dry brush technique that I've been talking about here is basically where I'm dragging the brush across the paper and there's very little water. I mean, you can see I can't even activate this white until I put water on my brush, you see? And actually, let's activate it so that way I can use it later. This little white gouache snuck on my palette, and I'm going to use it for some small details and highlights. But let's just activate it and let that get all worked up, and then we can come back to it. So for the dry brush technique, you can see I'm trying to use very little water. We're back in our dark purple mixture, and I'm just barely touching the paper here. Maybe create a little foreground shrubbery that has some shadow, just to tie the two land masses together. This one looks further away. And it looks further away because it's lighter and smaller. But I'll leave most of this just as it is. Alright. Now we have time for our white highlights. This is Winsor & Newton Designer's Gouache Permanent White. You don't have to use gouache if you don't want to. I just like it just to add some highlights and to fix mistakes. So there's one thing that's been bugging me throughout the course of this painting. Let's just get this ready first. I tested on a swatch to make sure it's opaque enough. That looks about right. Okay, so now what I have loaded on my brush should be good. There's this spot here. Do you see where the sun is supposed to be? There's like a dot here and I can't brush it off. It's just stuck there. So I'm gonna just get rid of it. Boop. Gone. Now this is where I consider the sun to be. So that works out in our favor. And now I'm going to use that same reflection technique for the sun. And let's put a bright spot right here. This should be about right. And you see, since it's a dry brush, it just sort of skims along the top of the paper and doesn't drip into the crevices of the paper. And this allows the water to look really sparkly. I need a little bit of water though, but I'll dump off the excess on my palette. It's still way too much water, so I'm focusing on the area where the sun will be. That's the brightest spot. And then as my brush drains of water, now I have a dry brush. So now, here we go. Okay, so we should be on our way to creating a sparkly water situation. I love some good sparkly water, don't you? You can see I'm pushing down on my brush and getting big strokes for the ones closest to us, and the ones further off in the distance are smaller, shorter, and lighter. This creates a lot of perspective, which is really great for landscapes. Alright, I think that should do it for our sparkly water. Now we could take this piece a lot further if you wanted. You could add a lot more detail, but I had a relaxing time and was able to accomplish this in one day, so I think we'll leave it here for today. But I hope that you come back and join me for the next one. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you liked this, and if you did, give it a thumbs up, and I'll show you the details. Here we go. And there we have it. Let's jump on into the neutral mix. My palette is cerulean blue, Prussian blue, burnt sienna, lemon yellow, and rose madder. Now, these pigments are pretty common throughout, so whatever brand you're using is fine. First, I'm grabbing Prussian blue, and I'm going to create a big puddle of that so I can work with it later. The one key thing about neutral mixes that I really, really insist on when I'm painting is that I create enough of it so I can use it throughout the course of the piece. And this is hard to judge, and sometimes you have to remix your neutral. Let me just check, make sure. Yes, that is Prussian blue. Alright, so now I'm going to grab burnt sienna, and we're going to add this because it is the complement to Prussian blue. And what that means is that it's opposite on the color wheel. Not precisely opposite, but pretty close. Burnt sienna is a dark orange, and a dark orange and a dark blue make a beautiful neutral. Most times when I'm painting with these two colors, I don't really fuss with adding too much else. But for here, I want to make a true neutral gray. So we'll see what this comes with. That looks a little too green for my taste. And I'm just swatching on a scrap to see. Now I'm going to add a little more blue, but knowing that this won't really fix it, it'll just make it bluer. And so since I know my color theory, we need to grab some of this and make a brown-gray mix. And this brown-gray mix should be a good foundation now to add rose madder. And hopefully, because it has a little bit of green tinge to it, let's see. I apologize if you can hear the airplane overhead. Let's see here. There we go. So we had a green and we just needed a little bit of red. Again, the complement. And now I'm just creating a nice big swatch of it so I can see how it reacts as both a light and a dark. I think that should work really well for our piece. So there you go. I hope that you've enjoyed this and learned a little something. If you have any requests, put them in the comments below. I'll try and get to everything I can. And thank you so much for watching. I really do appreciate it. And I hope that you had fun. I had a great time with you. Alright.